What's up, guys? Welcome back to another top 10 ranking video. In this one, I'm giving my opinions on the top 10 centers in the NHL right now. What we're gonna do is, again, like last one, start at the top, work our way down, throw in some honorable mentions, and that'll be the video. In my opinion, most of the best players in the league are centers, with a few exceptions on defense, wing, here and there, but if you were to map out probably the top 20 or 30 players, you might see about half of those players being centers. As always, guys, I want you to follow along, just listen up, listen to my rationale, and let me explain myself for each of my picks. Then I want you guys to drop your own top 10 in the comments below, and I'll be going through them and, again, starting some discussion. Also, be sure to drop a like on the video if you're enjoying these ranking vids and want to see more. Give me some other ideas as well for other things that I can rank. I've already done jerseys. I'm doing players by position now. If you have any other ideas, leave them in the comments below. Without further ado, let's start off this list at number 10. Number 10 is one of the best two-way forwards, if not the best, in the game today. He's brought his team to the Stanley Cup Final in 2013. Not too much playoff success lately, and the team's looking to be in a bit of trouble after trading away some big-name players, one who's actually already on this list as well. He falls to the top 10, of course, talking about Patrice Bergeron. Bergeron is a coach's dream. You can play him in any situation imaginable and he'll get the job done. On even strength, on the power play, on the penalty kill. And his numbers are actually starting to pick up with the emergence of Brad Marchand, David Pastrnak, and the like. But there are, in fact, 9 centers in this league that are more talented than him, in my opinion, so that's why he's at number 10. Number 9's a player that, you know, many of you guys, including myself, have kind of forgotten how talented he is. And I mean, his recent injury struggles have probably dropped him down the list a bit. He probably could be in the top 6, top 5 if he had been playing full years for the past few seasons. This, of course, is Stevie Stamkos. If you compare him to the other centers that are going to be on this list, he is a very different type of center, all right? He's not really great at draws. He's not really defensively gifted. He's not a playmaker. He's more of a pure goal scorer. And that's what I love about his game, is that he's so exciting to watch. He's basically the only guy right now competing with Ovechkin for, you know, the competition of how many one-timers can they score in season from the high slot. Obviously, Laine's coming into the league. He's going to get in on that action now. But Stammer, you know, he's really, really talented. But I just kind of forgot, and I really am craving more Stamkos goals, maybe another 60 goal season, who knows. We know what he's capable of, but he just hasn't done it in recent years, and that's why going into this season, I have him at number 9. Now, Boston fans, remember before I was talking about a player that you guys traded away, and you'll notice a few players on these lists, and I'm sorry, guys, to put you through that agony, but I mean, don't blame me, blame Chiarelli. I mean, he's the guy who committed all those crimes. So, of course, at number 8, we're talking about Tyler Seguin, one of the best young centers in the league today. Of course, he has benefited from playing with the likes of Jamie Benn. So that's obviously helped his numbers. And I mean, I think they might even get better this year because they brought Radulov on. So Seguin's numbers might be, you know, inflated with the line mates that he's had. But as a standalone center, I mean, he's still awesome. He's got speed. He's got an amazing shot. He's developed so much over the years. I don't know what Boston was thinking trading this guy away for basically nothing now. If you follow the trade tree, they've actually had nothing to show for it now. So, I mean, Boston fans, I'm sorry. I won't talk about him much longer, but I mean, Seguin is definitely one of the top centers in the league. In my opinion, he falls at number 8. Now, this player, I honestly don't know if he's a center or a winger. I mean, in fantasy leagues, they have him as kind of both, and he's capable of playing both. So I'm actually going to include him on this list, whereas I think NHL Network had him as a winger. I don't even think he knows where he prefers to play, but he can play anywhere. And that's what's great about Captain America himself, Joe Pavelski. The guy who actually stripped Joe Thornton, who's another great center, won't be on this list, but another great center. So took the captaincy from him, and then has led the Sharks to a Stanley Cup final in 2016 against the Penguins. Obviously, to ultimately lose, but he's one of the most dynamic centers / wingers in the league. And one of his skills that really stands out for him is his ability to stay in front of the net and get greasy goals, either by rebounds or deflections. He's got I would say, the best hand-eye coordination in the league, if not right up there with Sidney Crosby. Pavelski's super dangerous in any situation on the power play. I mean, he's got Joe Thornton setting him up most of the time. He's also played with Couture and Marlowe, though he won't happen. That won't happen this year. So I'm interested to see how, you know, maybe the decline of Thornton and the departure of Marlowe will affect Pavelski's numbers. Only time will tell. Number six is a player that I just honestly feel bad for. He's on a team that is disappointing year after year, underachieving, but he hasn't even had a single winger that's capable of playing up to his level. And they've been rotating in and out over the years, and they still haven't found somebody to play with John Tavares. He's one of the most skilled players in the league, and he still has yet to win his first Art Ross. He was neck and neck with Ben in the 14-15 season. I think Ben stole it in the last game of the season away from Tavares. So he's got all the numbers. I mean, he's consistently near the top of the league, but he's just got no support. And the fact that he's been near the top of the league in numbers consistently without having a supporting cast just speaks volumes to his skill level. So I think deservedly he's at number six. And before we cover the top five, I want to jump in and start talking about some of these honorable mentions. So our first honorable mention is going to one of the top young centers in the league today. No, I'm not talking about Auston Matthews yet. First, I got to give shout out to Mark Scheifele. It's pretty hard to spell his last name, but it's not hard to understand why I have him as an honorable mention. He's quietly been one of the most productive centers in the league. Of course, the one knock about him is that he has played alongside Blake Wheeler, Andrew Ladd, Brian Little, and now he's got the emergence of Nikolaj Ehlers and Patrick Laine. The Jets offense is set for the future, and I mean, that core might have been helping his numbers a little bit, but Mark Scheifele is awesome to watch. And he's only 24 years old. Last year he played on the North America, Team North America, 23 or under team. And he was one of their top players, one of their leaders, one of their veterans, you could say. And yeah, he tore it up, and he's only getting better. So Mark Scheifele definitely deserves an honorable mention on this list. Now we can get into the top five. And this guy is one of my favorite players to watch. He reminds me of one of my buddies who I used to grow up playing hockey with. A big, strong center that can literally do everything on the ice. He can shoot, he can pass, he can hit, he can fight, he can do anything you want. And a captain, this guy is Ryan Getzlaf. Now it's no secret that Getzlaf's numbers have always been good. You might say that's because he's been playing with Corey Perry, and I would argue that Getzlaf has helped Perry succeed much more than Perry has helped Getzlaf. Perry's kind of falling off on the charts, and you'll see that when I talk about right wingers. He's not even on the list, spoiler alert. So, I mean, Getzlaf is one of the top centers still in the league. Their last cup was in 2007, but he's helped their team go on to deep playoff runs in recent history. And looks like the Ducks are still ready to. They're not ready to fall off just yet. Getzlaf's a big reason behind that, and I think deservedly at that number five spot. Fun fact about number four, he actually inspired a skill zone video from NHL 16 that I did. So, I mean, if you want to look ahead, pause this video and go check, then you'll spoil it, obviously. This guy's one of the top playmakers in the league, if not in league history. We're talking about the first and only Swede on this list, Nicklas Backstrom. The guy who's been blessed with having Ovi playing on his wing for basically his entire career. So obviously that could have inflated his numbers a little bit, playing alongside Ovi on both even strength and the power play. You can take a look at Backstrom's numbers. Now most of his points are scored on the power play, but that doesn't take away from the fact that he's one of the silkiest passers in the game today, and there's a reason why he's consistently at the top of the league in points. One of the most underrated things about Backstrom's game, though, is his ability to use his body. He's got a huge butt that he uses to his advantage in the corners to create space for himself, shield the puck, get his wingers time and space to get open for him to feed them back door or set up Ovi for a one-timer and a surefire goal. So Backstrom, I think, definitely deserves a number four spot. Before we jump to the top three, I want to give another very special shout out, honorable mention, to one of the youngest players in the league and one of the brightest talents, up and coming stars. All right, no, obviously I have Connor McDavid in the top three. I'm not that dumb. I've got Auston Matthews as an honorable mention. Now, this is just something about me personally, but I find it really hard to give a lot of credit and weigh rookie seasons heavily. I'm not going to rank Auston Matthews in the top five just because he was in the top five in goal scoring, all right? So that's a little too generous. It might be anomalous, I mean, him playing alongside William Nylander and all the young guys, I mean, he was definitely the leader of the Leafs. There's no denying that. He was their best player, and he will be their best player for the foreseeable future, all right? There's no denying that. But, I mean, if you look at the other names on this list, I just don't think Matthews is with them right now. But for me, I just want to see him prove himself again this year, and then next year I do this, he'll definitely be in the top five. So I'm so happy to be a Leafs fan, and I'm so honored to give him a mention in this list. But back to the actual rankings now. Number three is one of the best Russian players in history, probably should have been on the top 100 list, because I know a lot of people were complaining about that. Too many Hawks, not enough Pens. This guy, I certainly agree with that assessment. Gino Malkin should have been on that list. So although he didn't make the NHL top 100, he makes my list of the top 10 centers in the league right now. And really, what's more important? So Malkin is just pure dominance. I mean, he's been living in the shadow of Crosby, but if you look at Malkin on his own, he could easily be a first-line center on any other team. And although he's had some recent injury struggles, I mean, his point per game numbers are at the top of the league. He also hasn't really had many wingers to play with. I know he's got Kessel now, but I mean, years ago, he still didn't really have anybody. Same like Crosby. Both of them have definitely paved their way on their own, and they definitely help out all the players that play with them rather than the other way around. And Malkin, I think, is one of the best players in the league, if not ever, and that's why he's at number three. I bet most of you clicked this video to see who I have at number one. Is it Crosby or is it McDavid? That was the debate all along, and that's going to be the debate for the next 3 to 5 years until Crosby declines, which I don't even know when that's going to be, all right? So, this one's tough. This one was really, really tough. I was considering going for the juicy bait in McDavid. You know, it's easy pick. He's the reigning MVP, Art Ross winner. But again, the young players. I mean, McDavid has only played 1.5 seasons. You know, he got injured in that first season, which destroyed his chances at the Calder, but then he bounced back stronger than ever with a Art Ross 100-point season. And I mean, there's basically nothing you can take away from this guy. He's the fastest player in the league. He might be the smartest player in the league, if not for Crosby. The one thing that I think McDavid has on Crosby is he's just more exciting to watch. If you watch McDavid these past two and a half seasons that he's played, he is just unbelievable. If you don't watch Edmonton Oilers games, you're missing it. It's like not watching LeBron James in the NBA or freaking Cristiano Ronaldo or Messi in football. Like, it's ridiculous. You have to watch him. It'll make you love the sport even more. So although McDavid is looking to potentially surpass Crosby next year or in a couple of years, I don't really have him as better than Crosby just yet, so he's going to be at number two for me. Now, I already gave away who my first pick is, because I said if it wasn't McDavid, it's going to be Crosby, so I might as well save you guys some time and put Crosby up there and just finish talking about him, as I was already kind of talking about McDavid and Crosby together. I mean, Crosby, you can't deny. He is the best player in the league right now. Some might have second-guessed that even a couple years ago when it was more focused on the Chicago dynasty and people were comparing Taves and Crosby, and whether a lot of people were saying Taves is better than Crosby just based on his trophy case and his resume. Well, if the past two seasons are any indication, Crosby's definitely caught up in the trophy category, and his numbers-wise just honestly blows Taves out of the water, all right? So I'm trying not to be biased here. I mean, I've got Taves on my back every single video, but Crosby, there's no denying he's the best player in the league right now. Back-to-back Stanley Cup champion, captained both those teams, and won the Conn Smythe in both of those years. Like, how do you argue with that? You cannot. I know McDavid beat him in regular season points, but I'm not looking at just the regular season. I'm looking at these players overall and how they perform overall, not just in the season. So Crosby's got a well-rounded resume. I don't think I have to say any more to justify my pick. So if you guys disagree with Crosby being at number one, I mean, that's your prerogative. You probably have McDavid at number one. If you have anybody else, I mean, you need to get your head checked. Now we still got one spot left on this list, outside this list actually. It's another honorable mention, the last one, and I've already mentioned his name before. I've got him on my back here every video. Sadly, he doesn't compare it to Crosby anymore. And he doesn't really fall on this list, but he is an elite talent nonetheless, and you cannot argue with his intangibles and his trophy case and all the stuff that he does during the game that may not be getting on the score sheet that contributes to his team's success. Tate's a player who knows how to score when his team needs it. He knows when to step up and lead by example. And I would say that's almost as close to as important as actually contributing on the score sheet. So even though his numbers haven't been that great recently, I think Taves is still one of the top centers in the league, and I'm looking for him to have a bounce back season this year as the spotlight, you know, shifts away from that second line as Panarin got traded away. More pressure will be put on him, and like I said, I think he'll thrive under that pressure and you'll see him bounce back next year. So guys, that pretty much sums up this video of my top 10 centers in the league right now. Drop a like on the video if you've enjoyed it. If you had any disagreements with any of my picks, feel free to leave a comment in the comment section below. Leave your own top 10 list there and we can have some discussion and some lively debate in there. Make sure you subscribe because I'm going through all the rest of the positions. I've got right wing, defense, goalie to cover, as well as other opinionated videos and kind of mini podcast episodes coming in once the season ramps up. So guys, be sure to stay tuned for that. And until next one, I'll see you guys then.